Hey everybody, welcome back to another edition of the Orthodox Nationalist, where we talk about things pertaining to the ancient Orthodox faith and to European medieval history, and we have a tendency here to focus on the nationalist vision both in Russia and Ukraine. And today we're going to continue on that tack, and we're going to talk about two very specific things. For the first part of this broadcast, I'm going to talk about somebody who I've wanted to speak about before but never have, and that is the Russian philosopher Nikolai Berdyaev. Berdyaev has been spoken about quite a bit, but recently has largely been ignored. He is a product of the 20th century. He is Russia's great existentialist and great anarchist thinker, and yet is an intensely spiritual man. And his main thrust in his work is a criticism of industrialization and its handmaiden, the social sciences. And then after that, we're going to talk about something else. We're going to talk about Fyodor Dostoevsky's concept of the European middle class, or the European bourgeoisie, something that doesn't get talked about very much relative to him. And so what we're really going to do here is we're going to talk about Russian responses to the modern world. The first, an exile from Russia, an exile because of the Bolshevik Revolution, a product of the 20th century technology. And the other, of course, far more famous, a man who's criticizing modernity from the point of view of the 19th century and from the point of view of one of the main sectors of modern development, and that is the bourgeoisie. The bourgeoisie in its specifically modern 19th century form, and he's talking about it both in the 19th century and both Western and Eastern Europe. So Nikolai Berdyaev. Berdyaev is somebody who deserves to be read and deserves to be understood. He's extremely controversial. There's really nobody who agrees with everything he says completely. Berdyaev was an anarchist. He was an individualist. He was a spiritualist. And he does all of this largely in reaction to modernity, technology, Bolshevism, and the social sciences. Berdyaev holds that Bolshevism is the ultimate example of what the scientific technique, when applied to human life, leads to. Bolshevism has one virtue, according to Berdyaev, and that is it's radically consistent. It holds human beings as something less than human. They do not have souls, and they therefore do not have freedom. In order for a human being to be free, he must have a soul. That soul, the seat of his reason and thought and feeling, in the Orthodox world sometimes it's referred to as the heart, meaning the center of the person, the soul must be immaterial. If freedom exists, therefore the spirit exists. If the soul is a material object, therefore it is not free. If it's a material object, then it is not free. It becomes just one of many physical things to be pushed around by the tyranny of cause and effect. Therefore, if freedom in any real useful sense of the word is going to exist, the soul, therefore, must be immaterial. There must be this heart of humanity that is not tyrannized over by cause and effect. That's where Berdyaev begins, the concept of freedom. But, you know, relative to 20th century Russia, needless to say, the problem is Bolshevism. Bolshevism is a very consistent concept of materialist cause and effect concerning technology, social classes, and the development of the technological potential of humanity. That's what it's really all about. But at its center, humanity is not free. There is no such thing as spirit in the Bolshevik mentality, and therefore there is no such thing as freedom. But Berdyaev's point is this is precisely the assumption of modern Western social sciences. The social sciences are designed to predict the reaction of humanity to certain external stimuli. The assumption behind that is that the human spirit is, in fact, not a spirit. It is a physical thing, and therefore it is subject to cause and effect, and in turn is subject to scientific prediction. If all of that is true, then humanity can be legitimately controlled. It can be controlled by a scientific elite. It's the famous French thinker Auguste Comte had developed this idea of a scientific elite that provides the proper stimuli to get humanity to do whatever it wants. Social science is based on this concept. Whether those people like it or not, it is based on this concept. If there is no soul, if there is no spirit, there is no freedom. If there is no freedom, then human action and human behavior is subject to a rigorous and very powerful scientific analysis. In addition, though, here's the problem. The problem is, if that all is true, then there is nothing particularly special about humanity relative to the rest of creation. And therefore, they could be manipulated at will, they could be destroyed at will, and there really is no concept of rights or duties or responsibilities outside of utility, outside of something being useful or profitable, and at least in the modern world, useful and profitable for the elite. Now, this is how Nikolai Berdyaev starts his philosophy. He starts it from the fact that in order for anything that we say about the world to make sense to a free person, the free person must, in fact, be possessed of spirit, something that is not material. That immaterial element is the soul and is the source of thought, of intellect, and the free will. Not the will, the free will. But in the 20th century, and I think most existentialists in the 20th century will agree, that the main ingredient in human thinking is both fear and flux. And the two are related. Things are constantly changing. They're changing at a rate very, very quickly. In fact, far quicker than the human mind was designed to withstand. There is fear, there is change, there is confusion, and these things are increasing at a tremendous rate because as technology increases, the speed of the machines and the image-making mechanism continues to increase. The human mind is not meant to respond to changes on an hourly or daily basis. That is not how the mind is designed. And a lot of mental illness and a lot of fear and a lot of struggle is based on the idea that the human mind is constantly having to adjust to a pace of life that's far faster than the human mind could ever adjust to. And Berdyaev is afraid that reason itself, which is based on freedom, and therefore based on spirit and immateriality, doesn't have any place to stand anymore. The one thing that Berdyaev says is clear about the 20th century is that all idols have fallen, including the idol of atheism. The only thing that's left is technology. A technology and a science controlled by a small elite, assuming that the human being is merely just another chunk of matter that therefore can be legitimately manipulated for the pleasure, and the needs, and the desires of that initiated elite who control technology and science. That the world of the average person in the 20th century is based on the world that is created by technics. But if the world is created by technics, that means that organic life no longer exists as any kind of organizing force. And in fact, what does organize things are machinery and, more importantly, the scientific establishment that controls that machinery. Here's the thing. Berdyaev is holding that humanity is necessarily free because of its spiritual nature and vice versa. Its spiritual nature means that it's free in the sense that it's not necessarily manipulated and dominated by cause and effect. You know, the way that atoms in nature are, and energy in nature is. The problem with that, specific to the 20th century, is that technology and the scientific elite who controls it is in charge of organizing the day-to-day life of humanity. Therefore, humanity is assumed to be material and therefore not free. The result of all of that is that the scientific elite, the scientific establishment, that's not science, by the way, let's make it clear, there's a huge difference between science and the scientific establishment. I mean, science is a legitimate search for truth. The scientific establishment is a wealthy, powerful, self-interested group of people who have a vested interest in maintaining their power and authority over society. Two very different things. They're not just different, they're opposed to each other. They're opposite each other. That the machine is their Frankenstein monster. They have created the machine, and it has deadened the sensitivity of the human mind and human feelings. Integrity, moral, free integrity of a free people has given way to stratification and even worse, managerialism. The idea that the day-to-day life of the average person, the average man, is in fact organized by a scientific elite for the sake of the profit of the few, of the initiated, for lack of a better word. Now, the old elites in European history were warriors and statesmen and philosophers and monks and saints. Our new elite is the scientific establishment and the managers, really another word for a bureaucrats, who in a purely routinized way, in a purely routinized day-to-day life, administer the life of almost all of humanity, at least in Europe and America. Managerialism means that the mediocre world of the bureaucrat dominates over everything. That this managerial elite is at the root, unconsciously so, but at the root of totalitarianism, whether it be of the Soviet variety or of the late 20th century Anglo-American variety. Either way, it is totalitarian in the sense that it manifests itself in every strata of human life. But that this totalitarianism, however it's manifested historically in the 20th century and the early 21st century, is based on technology and the scientific elite. And to support the scientific revolution, which is another way of saying the coup d'etat of the scientific elite, scientific establishment over human governments. And that includes the social sciences, and it includes economics, especially the economics of banking. You have to take seriously, then, its control and routinization and bureaucratization of all aspects of human life. So, Berdiaev finds himself, though, having, you know, that's very, very difficult to gainsay, everything that he's saying here. That's the basis of his criticism of modernity as a whole, whether it be Bolshevik Russian or Prussian German or Anglo-American. Either way, it's based on the same set of assumptions that goes by the name of the social sciences. What he's talking about, of course, isn't necessarily the idea of social reform, because social reform imposed from above can never be any improvement over that which it's trying to reform, because it still is based on a bureaucratic elite or a party elite or both, and it's usually both. And either way, it's based on coercion. And Berdiaev sees in Russia and elsewhere that the concept of revolution for most people really is just an excuse for antisocial behavior. It's an excuse for people to destroy that which threatens them or that which they don't like. But worst of all, Berdiaev fears the concept of system. All systems, whether they be of the economy or of thought or of anything else, they reduce the individual to a means. The individual becomes a means to an end. The individual is not taken seriously in and of himself, but he becomes a functionary. He becomes a bureaucrat. At root here, Berdiaev is holding that there is a really an irreconcilable distinction between the real integral personality and the outside world. Because there is this chasm between the free will manifest in the spiritual soul, as it must be, and the world outside the soul based on cause and effect, and therefore based on those elites who can manipulate that cause and effect, and therefore in turn is based on an initiated oligarchy who controls the world of technics that in turn can manipulate and control the world of cause and effect. So there are three great evils here. There is that radical individualism, collectivism, and democracy. All of these things are equally evil, because the individual is, if brought under the concept of ideology, that is to say, individualism, is evil because the integral personality is very, very different from the ego. In a materialistic world, you could still have an ego. The ego simply wishes to dominate the external world for its own profit. The integral personality does not wish that, or does not necessarily wish that. Collectivism is evil because the human personality is not, in Berdyaev's mind, the product of society. It is the product of spirit, and spirit usually is in revolt from society. And democracy is equally evil because it is based on the idea that freedom, political, social, economic freedom, is not based on political mechanisms. Political mechanisms may, under very tightly controlled circumstances, manifest freedom, but it is never the creator of human freedom. Society as such is always problematic because it is a collective based on circumstances. It's a collective based on the convenience of those who dominate and control it. Ultimately, for Berdyaev, community, which is an abused and misunderstood word, is an inner relation among equally integral personalities. It is never the product of external relationships. External relationships are always based on organization and compulsion. Real relationships can never be based on organization and compulsion. They must be based on free devotion and friendship. In Aristotle's sense of the word, the friendship among like equal souls, integral personalities, not egos, but integral personalities for the sake of some common good. And of course, that's precisely the opposite that we have to suffer with in the 21st century. That is a thumbnail sketch of the existential and anarchist philosophy of Berdyaev that is based on the soul, that is based on the spirit, and that is based on the idea of an integral personality. What do we mean by the concept of integrity? It means that the personality is based on a single idea. An idea that has been adopted in freedom, not in organization or compulsion or bureaucracy, but where every aspect of the personality reinforces every other aspect, and nothing is outside of that singular idea, but that is very rare anymore. And it's very rare because of the domination of organization and bureaucracy. So that is the 20th century Russian existential reaction to modernity, to the social sciences, to the scientific establishment, and to materialism. When we come back from the break, we're going to deal with an earlier criticism of a lot of these same things, but done from a slightly different point of view, and we're going to talk about Dostoevsky's reaction to the rise of the middle class, or, put differently, the rise of the European bourgeoisie in both Eastern and Western Europe in the middle, second half of the 20th century. So hang in there. We will be right back. Okay, everybody, welcome back to the Orthodox Nationalist. We spent the first part of the broadcast talking about Nikolai Berdyaev and his criticism of the social sciences relative to the state, totalitarianism, to organization and technology. All of these things he holds is essentially the same thing from different points of view. But a similar view is held by Dostoevsky in the 1860s, and specifically in a book called The Winter Notes. But these ideas exist throughout the Dostoevskian corpus. And, you know, something central when you read Dostoevsky, anything by him, is the concept of freedom. And it's not laid out directly, explicitly, the way Berdyaev lays it out. But there is the question of freedom relative to ego. Modern libertarianism seems to have this weird idea that freedom and egocentrism are one and the same thing. And, of course, not only are they not, both Dostoevsky and Berdyaev, not only are they not the same thing, but they're opposed to each other. And they're opposed to each other because egocentrism, this thrusting of the ego into the realm of all aspects of social life, that is completely consistent with the doctrine of materialism. It isn't freedom. The ego can be coerced and can be caused by the same thing that causes leaves to fall off in the fall, a simple scientific cause and effect matrix. But real freedom, of course, cannot be. Real freedom, by its very definition, can't be caused or coerced, and a cause is just a complete coercion relative to its effect. It can't be dominated by anything. That's what freedom is. So if you reject the idea of immateriality, that is to say, if you reject the idea of the spirit, you, by definition, ipso facto, you reject the idea of freedom, and there is simply no way out of that problem. But when Dostoevsky talks about the bourgeoisie, this particularly a modern manifestation, this bureaucratic social scientific world that all Russian writers, I mean, Pushkin, Gogol, Dostoevsky, Turgenev, all of these people associate with the great European capitals, the worst of all being St. Petersburg. It is simply the organization of organization. It is a bureaucracy for bureaucracy's sake. And if you want to say that Dostoevsky was a monarchist and Gogol, that's true. They were both firm monarchists, but they hated the idea of St. Petersburg and organization and bureaucracy. In fact, I'm going to go so far, and I know I'm with Gogol and Dostoevsky in this particular regard, that the Petrogradian bureaucracy was the negation of Russian monarchy. To claim that in the second half of the 19th century the Russian monarch was absolute is superficial, simpleton thinking. No, there was only one absolute in Russia in the late 19th century, and that was the bureaucratic apparatus. And that's something that most historians and social writers then and now don't grasp. The monarchy was not only limited, but was very much a figurehead dominated by an oligarchic, self-interested, scientifically organized bureaucracy. And this is something that the average Russian peasant was able to intuit in a way that the intellectuals could not. The Tsar was a good man. That's true. He was a good man. But the people who surrounded him and dominated him, the people who he depended on for information, they were not necessarily good men. They were victims of the same obsession with organization and the scientific technique that created modern managerialism, bureaucracy, and totalitarianism. The bourgeoisie came to power in the name of some abstract freedom, but it took very, very short period of time for them to show that they really only cared about their financial self-interest. And once that was taken care of, everyone else could go to hell. This is the bourgeois lie. This is bourgeois hypocrisy, because they're always going to talk about freedom, even as they spout from the other side of their mouth the doctrine of materialism. They'll talk about freedom and democracy, but what they really mean, of course, is to clear a path for their own control over the population, and most insidious of all, using these hapless, ignorant politicians to cover for their own crimes. So, for example, in modern America, you have the ignorant frauds of American talking heads talking about politicians, you know, presidents and Supreme Court justices and Speaker of the House and major senators and committee chairs and everything else having some control over the economy. The Reagan economy was good. The Bush economy was bad. The Clinton economy was good. The Bush 2 economy was bad. You know, the point is, of course, is that politicians usually have minimal control of the economy. Bankers and industrialists and currency traders and stock traders, these are the people who, collectively speaking, have control over the economy. And yet they spend a lot of time making sure that you think that this has something to do with these hapless, ignorant politicians. That somehow politicians are running the country, when in reality it's media elites and economic elites. Politicians are their front men who are shockingly ignorant about social philosophy and social theory and how power works. And they are said to run the country and run the economy and everything else, when in fact, of course, it is economic actors who run the economy. It's the major corporations and banks and media, and they are, of course, not elected, and they usually meet in secret, and the politicians, of course, take the blame for their success, and they take the blame for their failures. So the bourgeoisie, in fact, are the ultimate fraudsters. And we can go back to the Medici in Florence in Italy during the Renaissance to see how this is. I mean, the major bankers hide. They hire politicians to spout their line. They're given power and women and cash and everything else. And what's expected of them is that they take the fall for any failure of other non-elected economic actors, or in some cases, bureaucratic actors. That's the hypocrisy. That's the lie of bourgeois rule. And Dostoevsky, in Winter Notes and elsewhere, he talks about the middle classes, not just in Europe, but in Russia and Ukraine as well. And he views them as the ultimate in vulgarity. They want to be aristocrats without adopting the aristocratic virtues. It's very, very, you know, it's central in European history that economic elites try to buy aristocratic titles. And they want the power of the aristocracy, but without the social responsibility of the aristocracy. They want an aristocratic status, but they don't want the polish that comes with real aristocratic life. And they reduce intelligence to deviousness. Intelligence is largely confined to manipulating money or manipulating the labor of others. That they are not necessarily immoral people. They're too ignorant to fully understand one way or the other. They are amoral people. They're amoral people because they have assigned moral worth to those that are able to control money. And again, I want to say that money and stock, these things really represent the labor of the working class. And that is manipulated for the benefit of the middle and upper middle classes in modern society. So Dostoevsky and Berdyaev and Gogol, they are all talking about modern life as inherently deceptive, inherently exploitative. It's inherently evil. Evil in a way that previous societies could never be. And as I said before on this show, it has created a new religion. It's a new pantheon of pagan gods based on media image and money. What modern man worships are celebrities, and that these celebrities mirror almost exactly the old pantheon of the Greek and Roman gods. You have the warrior god, and you have the god of sexuality and sensuality. You have the god of power and money. You have the god of science. You have the god, you know, you have the political gods and social gods. This is the case in Egypt, Greece, and Rome. And you have it manifested, in some cases explicitly so, in the new pantheon of celebrities, you know, including people like, say, Obama or a certain general or a political figure or a banker or a capitalist like Warren Buffett. You know, I mean, you know, you have all of these gods and goddesses of this new modern pantheon, with a handful of media elites who are in the background manipulating how it actually works. And even worse than all of this is that this domination comes at the destruction of the natural world. Dostoevsky's writing this in 1862, 1863, and he's saying that wherever the capitalists come in, they'll destroy their surroundings, including the people. They'll destroy the natural beauty of the area with their smokestacks and everything else because they don't care. There's only one virtue, and that is the manipulation of the labor of others. You notice I don't even say it's about money. No, because money represents work. Money is the labor of other people. When you make money from an investment, you're making money from the sweat of those on the shop floor. And for these idiotic, middle-class, vulgar pigs who are, you know, investing in the stock market because they think that this is what, you know, this is what we smart middle-class people do, all you're doing is you're stealing more and more money from the average worker out there. All of this, Dostoevsky says, is called freedom by the bourgeoisie, both in Western and Eastern Europe. And therefore, you have Orwell before Orwell. Dostoevsky is talking about Newspeak, and he says explicitly that the middle class idea is that slavery is freedom. He talks about this long before George Orwell talks about it. Dostoevsky brings up the Old Testament pagan god or family of gods, Baal. Baal is in fact just an overlord, but an overlord in the sense of a property owner in the Old Testament. Baal is something extremely important to the Russian writers throughout the 19th century because Baal and his close cousin Moloch are the devourer of children. These are the gods to whom the Middle Eastern pagans would sacrifice their children to. Child sacrifice disappeared for the most part in Greek and Roman paganism, although maintained itself throughout the Phoenician lands and the Middle East. They would sacrifice an innocent child in exchange for peace and plenty in the future. Baal, though, in Dostoevsky's mind, is something very, very real in the modern world. Baal is that fetish or fetishization of all natural cause and effect, the lowest plane of being. Dostoevsky explicitly mentions Baal as the ultimate idol, the idea of an idol, the idol that stands behind all other idols. And it poisons everything it touches, including revolutionaries and reformers, because it assumes that everything, including humanity, is based exclusively on cause and effect. Dostoevsky and Gogol, in one way or another, hold, in Dostoevsky's case explicitly, that Baal is behind everything in modernity. And when he says behind, he means the mentality of old ancient Middle Eastern and Phoenician paganism, the paganism that the prophets condemned both in Israel, ancient Israel I should say, as well as those apostate Israelites in Tyre. Tyre became the signal, the sign, the icon of all commercial empires. And, of course, it's the Tyranians who developed the commercial empire of the Middle East and then in Carthage. And I think it's the mentality of Tyre that eventually developed into the Masonic lodges and developed the idea of Great Britain as the ultimate, Great Britain and the Netherlands as the ultimate commercial empire, and now rests in the Jews of New York City, the Jews and those connected with them in New York City. That it is the Tyranian mentality that dominates everything in the modern world. The modern bourgeoisie is really a resurrection of the ancient Tyranian mentality. Tyre is explicitly mentioned in the Old Testament, but is mentioned as that which is condemned in the most violent terms by the prophets, even when all of Israel was serving Baal. Remember this. The Old Testament does not romanticize Israel. It condemns Israel over and over and over and over again. The point of the prophets is to spit on the dominant oligarchy of Israel. You have exceptions, you know, like Josiah and other people like that, but in general, Israel served Baal, not God. This is why the Talmud condemns Isaiah and Jeremiah as much as it condemns Jesus Christ. This is what these ludicrous Catholics and Protestants don't get. The Talmud condemns Isaiah and Jeremiah. It condemns them to hell because they condemned the dominant Israelite oligarchy of the Old Testament to hell. And they had the authority to do that. And they did it because the Israelites were serving Baal and serving the mentality of Tyre, and which later developed into Carthage. The commercial worship of money, which eventually is the worship of matter, and therefore as technology develops, the organization of matter, which becomes in the social world, bureaucracy, the overweening state, and the man, remember, who died in heresy, Solomon himself. Solomon is not a saint. Solomon died as a materialist, Baalist, and ecumenist in his day by marrying hundreds of women and bringing their pagan gods into the temple. And he died in this state. He was cursed. I mean, he did good things, of course. As did Plato and Aristotle, it doesn't mean that what he did in the religious sphere was false. All of this is central because Dostoevsky, and I think the Orthodox tradition as a whole, whether Greek or Russian, says that it is this Israelite worship of Baal, which is at the center of developed Judaism and Israelitism, both in the Old Testament and in the modern world, manifest ultimately in New York, in Los Angeles, and Hollywood. It is this worship of Baal that is at the basis of everything modern. And it's not an accident that the two states that were involved politically in promoting this were Great Britain and the Netherlands. It's also these two states that had a large number of Jews, and that these Jews were heavily involved in the slave trade, both white, and especially in the case of the Irish, and black in the case of the Africans. But this is not this isn't something that modernity can just paper over. It is at the very heart of modernity. Reason doesn't matter because reason exists only for the sake of making money, which is another way of saying manipulating the labor of others. So what we're talking about is the negation of reason. Scientific reason, the way that the Enlightenment defined it, is negation of reason. Because ultimately, it existed to the service and at the service of those capitalist and mercantilist organizations in Britain and in the Netherlands that were, I mean, the Hanseatic League, even in the late Middle Ages, dedicated to the worship of matter, the worship of money, the state, and exploitation. Passion dominates reason. Reason is just a slave to the passions. The triumph of reason, so-called in the modern world, is the triumph of the passions that control it. And those passions are the lust to dominate, to control, and to enslave in one way or another. This, ultimately, is what brings Dostoevsky and the existentialist Nikolai Berdyaev together over the space of roughly, maybe 80 years between the two of them, and creates this very coherent Christian critique of modernity, of the modern world, and what the modern world is based on. It is not based on reason and science. That is a myth. That is a lie. That is a story. The modern world is based on the lust to dominate and control. And so words like reason were redefined to refer to that kind of deviousness, devious intelligence, like a cat hunting in the middle of the night, to control labor, to control the population through the state, through organization, through bureaucracy. Science was redefined to refer to the manipulation of matter for the sake of the elite. All of this stuff. Freedom was redefined in modernity to refer to the domination of the ego, not the free will or the free reason, the ego of the elite to control everyone around them. Modernity is based on fraud. It's based on using the same language, but changing those words and changing that definition. Things like freedom, like science, things like intelligence and rationality, all of these have been manipulated and changed for the sake of satisfying the lust of an elite. And we are in this year, 2010, coming to the end of 2010, we are in their control. And we are dominated by them, and our work and our task, therefore, is to create in our own world islands of sanity in a sea of insanity. So I hope you guys understood what I'm saying. Please email me with any questions. I usually respond right away, depending on my schedule. And I want to thank everyone. The Voice of Reason, Mike especially, who's helped me throughout all of this and has gotten my shows together. I appreciate everything, and I appreciate this network and what we can do to help our world. Thank you very much. God bless, and bye-bye.